And one of the things we feel like the church has done is they've taken steps backwards to acknowledging and realizing that every day there's a principality and a power, according to Scripture, that wants to stop you and your family, wants to stop your business, wants to destroy your thinking, wants to hurt you in every area of your life because you are a Christian and he hates your guts and you're made after the image of God. If we just continue, and there's years of experience talking to you right now, if we just continue just to hope that the problems and the pressures of life, illness, depression, discouragement, frustration, aggravation, anger, just uncomfortable, whatever it might possibly be, life itself, we just hope that it goes away and it's a normal thing, I'm here to tell you, you're going to get beat up from pillar to post. God talks about demonic activity in the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament, all through Scripture. Jesus himself dealt with it. And the other night when we saw Marilyn Hickey and she gave us a picture of what she was doing in Pakistan, and we saw all those people where demons were coming out of these people. In our country, we don't have that issue. Our demons are so subtle, they'd much rather just leave you sort of alone so that you don't know they're there. They're like incognito, and they torment, torture, divide, and conquer you in every area of your life. And before you know it, you don't even know that your family, your finances, your dreams, vision, destiny, and purpose, even though you're a Christian, has been so under attack, you want to give up and you want to quit. And it's time for us to remind ourselves, and that's what we're going to do tonight, is realize that we do have an enemy and how to deal with that enemy and how that enemy comes and how and what God expects from you and I as Christians on dealing with the enemy. Deborah's going to do the first part and I'm going to come up and do the last 10 or 12 minutes of the last part. So give the Lord a great big praise. Is that okay?
So tonight we're going to get into spiritual and demonic warfare, which is spiritual warfare. So why don't you stand with me and let's pray and let's ask God to give us light and that he would shine light in the darkness and that we would be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Amen? So Father, we thank you for the word of God. We thank you for the revelator of the church, the Holy Spirit, who is our teacher. Tonight, as we open your word, Lord, I ask that you would teach us and instruct us. We live in a natural world, and it's very easy for us to fall prey to our natural senses. Awaken us, help us, give us wisdom that we may be the people you need us to be in this hour. And we thank you and we give you praise in the mighty name of our King and our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. I want to talk to you tonight. My part of this in the next 20 minutes is to talk to you about winning the invisible war. And like Jim said, this is going to be information that many of you already know. Some of you may not, but we're going to remind you because we are in a time right now in history in the United States of America. We are in a political year. And if you have not followed any of the debates from our two Democratic and Republican parties, then you're missing something because I have never seen such a circus in my entire life. And at first I thought, no, this can't be happening. And then as I watched, I realized that we are in a very, very serious time. And that this is not a time to fall asleep. This is not a time to be young and carefree. This is a time to be grown-ups. This is a time to wake up, and this is a time to be the church that God needs us to be, because our nation is at a crossroad, and a very serious crossroad. I'm reading historically about the Civil War, and it was amazing to me that the Civil War, out of all the wars that have ever been fought in the United States, and men and women that have died throughout those wars, from the Revolutionary War all the way through to present-day wars, about 1.2 some odd million men and women have given their lives in our warfare. In the Civil War, 622,000 men gave their lives. 644,000 gave their lives in all the other wars. The carnage and the destruction that happened in the Civil War was beyond our comprehension as Americans in the 21st century. And if you think that we are not in a civil war right now, you are wrong. We are in a moral war right now. We're in a war of ideologies, and we are in a war, and this country is divided, and it's getting nasty, and it's getting harsh and rude, and it's foolish. We have many, many situations in the United States right now that are extremely serious. And I'm talking to grown-ups tonight, so don't zone out on me and say you don't care, because this is going to affect your children and your children's children. We have, just something to think about, we have racial prejudice right now in this nation like I haven't seen since the 60s. I was born in 1950, so I went through the 60s, and I remember the Civil Rights Movement and the women's movement. I was in college, and I was burning my bra, and I was marching with everybody else until I found out about the two kingdoms. We have a debt crisis that we're not really addressing. Unfunded liabilities that are going to choke our gross national product so that there'll be no money left for anything else, not even a military. And I'm serious. Unfunded liabilities simply mean that when you have things that you have to pay and you do not have the assets to pay them, that is an unfunded liability. Medicare, Social Security, these massive programs that the United States has are unfunded. There is not money for them, but we're not talking about them, which means that this is going to be on the backs of the next generation and the generation after that, my grandchildren. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We have an educational crisis in this nation. We are 29th in the world as far as schools. 29th in the greatest country in the world, supposedly. You can fact check that. We've lost jobs, good paying jobs, into a global market. 63% of all the new jobs that were created in this recession are low paying jobs. We are moving goods and services, but we're not manufacturing. Have you noticed that? And America is angry. That's why we're seeing the carnage. That's why we're seeing the rudeness and the crudeness. Americans are angry. Anyone in here frustrated and angry? There aren't great paying jobs right now. They've all gone overseas. There are security issues that are looming over our heads with terrorism right in our own backyard. Do I need to remind you that The Rock was the vetting place when there was the terrorist attack on Waterman? Our Supreme Court, one of the judicial branch of our government, there are three branches. There is the executive, there is the legislative, and there is the judicial. These founding fathers of ours purposely wrote this Constitution and designed this government, I believe, under the hand of God, and that there would be checks and balances so that the executive would enforce the laws. The legislative, which is the Senate and the Congress, would make the laws, and the judicial, which is the Supreme Court, would interpret the laws. But we have a judicial system in this nation that has completely redefined the family, redefined marriage, redefined the right to life, redefined all of the Judeo-Christian beliefs that this nation was centered on when it came into being under the mighty hand of God. And as the Church of the Living God, we need to see this and realize this. I watched in the 50s, and I watched in the 60s, and I watched in the 70s as the landmarks were moved and moved and moved and moved, and my generation was rebellious and foolish. And now I'm seeing again that there's a whole new foolishness and blindness and stupor that is over our nation. And this is due to principalities and powers and demons and Satan's kingdom and church. We are the ones that God has called to wage spiritual warfare against what the enemy wants to do. His desire is to kill, to steal, and to destroy, to take this nation out, to take this next generation out. And God has the Church of the Living God on planet Earth to wage the good fight of faith and to do what we're supposed to do. We are his hands, his legs, his body on this planet. And I want to talk about the three arenas of warfare, and then I'm going to hand it over to Jim, and he's going to tell us how to fight this thing. So I know I've painted a bleak picture of this nation, but you live in it, and so do I. And maybe you're too young to know, really, how much things have changed. You're just too young yet. I pray that you'll stand long enough, and you'll be old enough to be able to look back and remember. Because things can change overnight and very quickly. One Supreme Court decision can change everything. It did in my lifetime with abortion. If it would have changed when I was pregnant and out of wedlock and not married, I would never have had my oldest child, Miranda, and she'd not be pastoring with her husband today. That's how much things can change in just one decision. So I want to talk to you tonight about the three arenas, the three theaters of warfare. Now, we know that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers and heavenly places. This war is an invisible war. It cannot be won by the arm of the flesh. It can only be won in the spirit realm. We know by faith in Hebrews chapter 11 that the invisible created the visible world. We know that according to Genesis, that there was the fall of mankind, that this planet and these two political parties and this political system, and as wonderful as America is, it is a fallen system, and it will eventually wear itself out because it is not founded by the messianic kingdom of God. And the only thing that's going to happen is that we are on God's timetable. He has a timetable for planet Earth. We are here to bring the kingdom of God into this earth through salvation and the preaching of the gospel and doing the things that God's called us to do. But perfection and heaven will not come to this planet until Jesus comes back. We are not going to make heaven on earth here through the foolishness of a fallen race. Only through the king. So there's three arenas that Satan, the enemy, has designed to fight us and to take us out. Now, I want to just read you something, and I want to talk about Satan for just a moment. He was called the anointed cherub who covers, Lucifer, the son of the morning. He's called the prince of demons in Matthew 9:34. He's called the devil, the one who trips you up, the old serpent. He's subtle, he's crafty, the great dragon, terrifying, or the destructive beast, the evil one to cause others to be as corrupt as he is. He's called a murderer, a thief, and a liar, a lawless one. He's as a roaring lion. Jesus says he's the ruler of this world. He's the prince of the power of the air. He is vehemently against all that you stand for. He hates us because we are made in the image of God Almighty. He sees us as sheep for the slaughter, and he thinks we are cowardly and weak and foolish. And church, we've got to grow up and stand against this power that's trying to take out America. I'm not telling you how to vote. I am telling you how to fight. And you pray and ask God how to vote. But get in this game with me, because we got to start praying, because there's some serious things coming down. So let's look at number one. There's three arenas: the mind, there is the church, and there is the heavenlies. Those three arenas, three theaters of warfare: the mind, the church, and the heavenlies. I'm going to look at those very quickly, and I'm going to hand this over to Jim. Let's look at the mind. The mind. The point is if you control the reality of people, you will control their thoughts, which will control their actions. Change men's thoughts, you will change men's actions. Thought comes first, and then the creative act. God command, he conceives the plan. The word commanded the plan. The spirit created the plan in Genesis chapter 1. The father conceived it. Thought came first before matter. Then the word was made flesh, the word spoke it, declared it, let there be light, and there was light. Thought came before matter. Are you with me? And then the spirit, hovering over the waters, created that which was commanded. Thought comes before action. The reality is, satanic principles know that if you can control the thoughts of men in their minds, you will control their actions. If you can tweak their perspective, you will cause them to fail and not be who they are designed to be, made in the image of Almighty God. And in this fallen world, when Adam handed the title deed of planet Earth over to Lucifer, who is Satan himself, Now all of a sudden the kingdom of darkness came in, and the two kingdoms, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness, are vehemently opposed to each other, and there is warfare going on. First in the realm of the mind of mankind, the realm of the church, and the realm of the heavens. So, you change men's thoughts, you change men's minds. Satan's reality is lies. His reality is a lie, John chapter 8, 44. You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Listen to the voices that are speaking to you to get your vote, and see if there is truth or if there is hypocrisy and lies. What father do they belong to? Out of the mouth, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Listen, don't put yourselves asleep to what's going on. If Satan and his demons can cast doubt on God's word, he will cause confusion and unbelief. When he causes confusion and unbelief, he will positively cause you and I to fail. Because in the kingdom of God, we win. But in the kingdom of darkness, the old kingdom, if we go back to that direction, we will lose. So he's trying constantly to divide you from the word of God. Why? Because God's reality is truth. Satan's reality is deception and lies. God's reality is truth. John 17, 17. Sanctify them. This is the prayer of the Lord. Sanctify them in your truth. Your word is truth. You want to know what truth is? It is the word of God. That is the truth of God. He's the father of lies in the kingdom of darkness, and he is the king of truth. His word is truth. He said, my words will not return void. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my thoughts above your thoughts. And as the rain comes down and waters the earth and gives seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that proceeds out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that what I have sent it to do. God's word is truth. He's the king. The reality is in the mind. If he can separate you from the truth of God's word, you have just lost the battle. Case in point, I'll go quickly. Peter, when he was walking on the water, do you remember that? Matthew chapter 14, you know the story. Jesus is visiting them, walking across the water on the Sea of Galilee, because he sees them in his prayers that there's a storm that Satan has kicked up and they're about to drown. He walks to them. They're scared. And Peter cries out and says, Lord, if it's you, bid me come. And so just so that you can see the word, I want you to look with me in Matthew chapter 14, verse 29. So he said, come. Did Jesus say come? Did he say come? Is the word truth? Peter, on that word, faith rose in his heart, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I'm talking about a lie versus the truth. Peter gets out of that boat. He begins walking on the water. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water and got to Jesus. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched out his hands, caught him, and said, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? So the enemy comes in your mind to separate the word that has gone forth, the word that he has spoken over you. Come. You're on the water, you're in a storm, you've gotten out of the boat, but here comes the master of deception to separate you. If you can get your eyes on the natural corporeal world that you live in and get them off of the supernatural invisible world, you'll begin to sink. But God said, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Peter, you were in the water with me. I said, come, and you obeyed me, and you walked on the water, for crying out loud. It's in the mind. You change your thoughts, you'll change your actions. Number two, the reality of the spiritual battle is the church. The church is the body of Christ on the earth. His body, representation of him. God created us in his image. He put his nature in us. We are new creations. We are extensions of him. He's in the heavens. We are on the earth. The Holy Spirit is with us. We are joined with Him, joint heirs with Jesus Christ. There is no separation. And the reality is, if we can begin to believe, victory will begin with the name of Jesus on our lips, but it will be accomplished by the nature of Jesus in our hearts. The battle is obedience, which brings authority. The church has the authority. Matthew 28, 18 through 20 through 29. I'm going to have to put my glasses on because everything's blurry. Jim, I'm taking too long. I'm so sorry. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given unto me in heaven and earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded. And lo, I'm with you always, even until the ends of the earth." The church, it is accomplished. The authority that has been delegated to us is in the name of Jesus. And our grounds are what He has won for us at Calvary's cross and resurrection. He has defeated and spoiled principalities and powers. He has the keys of death and hell. So first we got to know what He's done. But then the power of delegated authority comes through us, and it's accomplished through obedient faith. Like tonight when Jim was telling you to shake off the dust and shake off the thoughts, the undisciplined thoughts, and get into praise and worship. Why? Because God inhabits the praises of His people. And when you and I just begin to get out of our natural world and our own thoughts, and we begin to focus on Him, suddenly the atmosphere changes. Suddenly everything changes. Even though nothing changed, everything changed. Obedient faith. The church, when the church is obedient, like the centurion who understood authority, when that centurion came to Jesus and he had a sick son, and the centurion met Jesus and said, "Don't even come to my house. I'm not worthy that you come. Just speak the word only. I'm a man in authority. I say go to this one and he goes. I say go to that one and he goes, and they obey me. You just need to speak the word, King of glory, and my servant will be healed." He understood delegated authority. Why? Obedience. In the army, in the military, if you don't obey your commanding officers, you're not in the military very long. You have no power if you are not watching each other's back, and you are not in obedience in rank, not breaking rank, not usurping authority. If you are under authority, you have authority, the church. Now, the last realm is in the heavenlies. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10. To the intent now, Paul writing to the church, and in this prayer, that the manifold wisdom of God, the many-faceted wisdom of God, like a diamond with all of its different cuts and facets, unfathomable, the wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in heavenly places. What does that mean? Paul's saying the church is revealing the wisdom of God. The church is revealing the wisdom of God. The church is revealing the power of God. The church is revealing the resurrection victory of God through the born-again church that is obedient, that has had its mind renewed to God's thoughts and not the lies of the enemy, who knows how to walk in the Spirit and not after the flesh. The church represents Jesus on this planet, and we show the principalities and the powers, the wisdom of God. They're watching, and there's a battle. What does that mean? It means, when it comes to angelic and demonic warfare, the battle rests not in a physical battle, but in the power of agreement between mankind and the spirit realm. Listen to this. When it comes to angelic and demonic warfare, the battle rests not in physical battles, but in the power of agreement between mankind and the spirit realm. If Satan can get you to agree with him, he wins. If we can begin to agree on earth as anything that's touching heaven, the kingdom of God takes ground and moves. What does that mean? It means that there are princes and there are kings in this world. And over these princes, there are demonic kings. Let me show you. Jim, come on up, because you're going to need time. That is why you see princes and kings in the Old Testament. What do I mean by that? What are you talking about, Pastor Deb? Well, in Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 1 and 2, it says, "The word of the Lord came to me again, saying, Son of man, say to the prince of Tyre, thus says the Lord God, because your heart is lifted up, and you say, I am a god, I sit in the seat of gods, in the midst of the seas, yet you are a man and not a god, though you set your heart as the heart of a god." So he's talking to a man, is he not? He calls him a prince. Are you in agreement with that? Watch Ezekiel 28:12. Now he switches over. "Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre." First there was the prince, now there's a king. "And say to him, thus says the Lord God, you were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were the anointed cherub who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones." He's not talking about a man. He is talking about Lucifer. There are demonic beings over princes and over nations. There are princes and there are kings. Now, in the Messiah's kingdom, let me show you this one, Isaiah 32. Verses 1 and 2. "Behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes will rule in justice. A man will be as a hiding place from the wind, and a cover from the tempest, as rivers of water in a dry place, as a shadow of a great rock in a weary land." In Satan's kingdom, there are princes and there are principalities, kings over them. For instance, North Korea, possessed. That ruler is crazy. We sat with somebody in the mission that was in the mission field 9 times in North Korea. He told us about the new ruler in North Korea. How insane. Hitler was possessed by a principality. Stalin, possessed by a principality. Don't think that the American political situation does not have its principalities and its demons over Washington, D.C. Just because they wear suits and it seems like they're bound by some kind of law doesn't mean that there's not a spiritual warfare and a battle raging in our nation right now. The battle rests in the power of agreement. Who is going to rule man's thoughts and man's actions? Where the church is weak, carnal, passive, loveless, and indifferent, the powers of hell increase. Nations are taken by possessed rulers like North Korea, Hitler, Stalin. Marriages and families weaken. Murder, sexual immorality, wanton living increases, and evil moves in. When the church is aggressive in its agreement with the heavens through the living in the will of the word of God, when we are aggressive and we live in the word and the will of God, when we are aggressive and we live in the will and the word of God, the presence of God increases. We displace satanic principalities and the kingdom of heaven moves in and hell moves out and God's kingdom moves in. 3 arenas, the mind, the church, the heavenlies.
Let me just turn this on. A lot of times we don't understand this, but Paul writes to Ephesians, in Ephesians, the book, as he writes to the church at Ephesus, and he writes this in the 6th chapter, verse 12. He says, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this age, and against spiritual hosts and wickedness in heavenly places." I mean, there is a real structured enemy that is like a military that knows what it's doing with assignments to do everything it can to stop you, stop the government, stop your job, stop your finances, stop your marriage, stop your children. If you don't start taking authority, I can't do it for you. In fact, we were talking about it this morning. Foolish people follow a foolish man. And then you have the outcome of Adolf Hitler and Idi Amin.
The Civil War.
Foolish people that follow a foolish man. What makes foolish people? Not because they call them Christians, because a lot of those people are Christians. A lot of the German Nazis were called Christians, called themselves Christians. A lot of Idi Amin's people who slaughtered tens of thousands of people were people called Christians. You know what the difference was? There's a Christian that knows what to look for and battles and understands that. And then there's the people who call themselves Christians that just follow like stupid sheep. And when foolish people that follow like stupid sheep, even though they're called Christians, follow a foolish man who's not lined up with the Word of God, just a bunch of hot air, then we have a whole society that's failing.
That's exactly what happened in the Civil War, is the pastors preached that slavery was God's will. The North said, no, it's wrong, it's a sin. They're men and women just like us. We all have red blood. It doesn't matter what color our skin is. And they led the South into secession, and 600 and some odd thousand men from the North and the South were slaughtered because of foolish, stupid, wrong men of God and people that would not change their ways. America, wake up. This can happen to us.
And that's why tonight we felt really moved by God to bring this to your attention, not only on the as far as our government, but you can't just follow someone and be stupid and call yourself a Christian and expect to be protected for everything and everything's fine. You are responsible for what your future is going to be like according to whether or not you do the Word of God or don't do the Word of God. So there's three realms that Debbie talked about in spiritual warfare. Let's talk about them for just a moment. The first one, if you remember, was what? The mind. Right here. If he can get you to think screwed up stuff that's wrong, and all of a sudden you're following what you think is right, but it's wrong. And because you think it's right doesn't make it right. What God says is right. That's what's right. Doesn't matter what our feelings say. Doesn't matter what our society says. Doesn't matter what social systems say. Doesn't matter what the Supreme Court comes up with. Doesn't matter what the laws of the land are. Majority rules. Not in God's kingdom, it doesn't. And you're now part of God's kingdom. I wouldn't be talking that way to you if you weren't somebody who came along and said, hey, I'm a Christian. I love God. I'm in church to do something. If I'm in church to do something, then learn something. Because if you don't know anything, you'll become a foolish person following a foolish group of people and end up voting and doing things that are absolutely crazy. We've got people that are leading right now in America that are nuts, man. That are just saying, I love you, I love you. Do you know why most people say they love you? It's like people who win an Academy Award. They come up and say, I love you, I love you. You know what they're really saying? I love you because you give me attention. I don't love you because of who you are. My God, somebody's running for president of the United States has never worked a day in his life. He wasn't born with a gold spoon in his mouth. He was born with a silver spoon in his mouth. Solid silver and diamonds. And here he's going to relate with us and say, oh, I love you, I love you. Let me tell you something. He doesn't love anything except himself and money. And I don't want to see our country fail of that. I don't want to see our churches fail of that. They're godly people that are not afraid to say it like it is and stand up for Jesus Christ right now. I love what Ben Carson said. What a godly man, Ben Carson. He just got out of the presidential race tonight. But you know what he said? America will vote in what they deserve. Oh my God, what a prophetic word from a Christian. They'll vote in what they preserve. They always, foolish people, follow a foolish leader. But you don't have to follow if you know what's truth. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Is anybody listening tonight? I'm not telling you who to vote for. I'm just telling you to open your eyes and check it out by the Word of God tonight. One thing we have never done in 20 or 30 years of ministry at this church has ever gotten political. But our nation, in fact, Debbie and I are leading a prayer meeting on Sunday night about our nation. Because we're not going to put up with this. This is a church that's going to pray for the leaders of this nation. We're not going to let somebody come in and Shanghai the Constitution. And somebody come in and take people who don't know what the heck they're doing and tell them something that's foolish and take them off and lead them down a path so his ego can be there. It's ridiculous, my friends. Now, if you don't like that, go find a church that'll let you do that. This church is not putting up with junk. Demonic junk. It's demonic junk. And we're not going to put up with it. I'm not telling you who I'm talking about. Didn't say a word. Three areas in the mind. Number one battleground for you, your marriage, your finances, dreams, your vision, your children, everything that you have. There'll be a battle in your mind. It says God's not there, doesn't work, This is what everybody else is doing. I prayed. I don't get results. I guess I'm on my own. I don't know what to do. But if you know the Word of God, just because you didn't get an immediate answer to the prayer doesn't mean the prayer doesn't work. You are a product right now of what we, Debbie and I, prayed 30 years ago. When I prayed it 30 years ago, I was discouraged in my mind because I didn't see any results. But now, 30 years later, this is the results. Are you listening to what I'm saying? And guys, my point being is this. This is a mind that wants to just be discouraged, wants to be frustrated. And people can say things like, I said something really stupid to one of my daughters the other day that just came out of my mouth. It was stupid. I won't tell you what it was. It was just a wrong thing. I had to apologize a half a dozen times because it just sounded wrong. I didn't mean it wrong that way, but it sounded wrong. And I know that just broke her heart. And I've been sick about it for days. And it's like people can be, even me, can be used by an influence that's contrary to the ways of God. But if you know you who you are, know how to fight this battle, when things come at you, they won't ever destroy you. I can't tell you how many people say to me all the time, you know, I've been hurt by the church. Okay, you've been hurt by the church. Who cares? You're not hurt by Jesus. You know, that's how you, people will always hurt you. But you're not hurt by Jesus. Come on, let's get going. Let's don't stop what God wants us to do because someone hurt our feelings. Let's get up, let's forgive, let's get going. I love this, 2 Corinthians, if you'll go there in the 10th chapter, 2 Corinthians, are you there? And it says these words, 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. Verse number 3 says this, for though we walk in the flesh, listen to this, Paul writing the church at Corinth, preserved for thousands of years. Why? So you could look into the heart of God tonight and see something about yourself. He says, though we walk in the flesh, man, don't we? Don't we? But we don't have to follow the flesh. We don't have to live by the flesh. We don't have to do the flesh. I just live in the flesh. I can't help that. Someday the eastern sky is going to split and I'm going to shed my flesh. How about you? I'm like an old snail with a shell on. I'm going to get rid of my shell and keep on moving. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. In other words, a different warfare designed for you. In order for you to win this, you're going to have to realize there's a different warfare. Yes, your mama planted seeds of discouragement. Yes, your uncle came through the windows at night and violated you. Yes, people called you loser, fat, ugly, terrible, never going to make it. You're a nothing. But I'm here to tell you something. None of that's God. I want you to know something. That's a demonic thing trying to keep you from being all that God would have you to be. Get over it and let's move on. Because there's a different warfare. Verse number 4 comes along and says this word. For the weapons of our warfare. Oh, now he's going to talk about the weapons are not carnal. In other words, physical. We don't pick up a stone and hit somebody. We don't hit them with a rock. We don't get mad and stab them with a knife or shoot them. That's not the way our warfare is. Our warfare as a Christian is different. And he says the warfare are not carnal, but mighty. Watch this. In God to the pulling down of strongholds. Every one of us have strongholds on the inside of us that want to keep us from being all that God wants us to be. And if you'll take authority in the net, she talked about that authority that God has given you and start to use it against that stronghold that keeps you from not being what God wants you to be and says what God says you are. And instead of that, you use that. Guess what? You're going to do something. You're going to pull down those strongholds. How do I do that? How do I do that, Pastor Jim? Verse 5, watch what it says. Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. There are things that are going to come against you in your thought process that are going to exalt themselves against what God says about you. Let me say it again. There are things in your thought process that are going to exalt themselves against what God says about you. God says you're a king's kid. God says you're washed by the blood. God says, listen, there's only one race, the human race. My goodness sakes alive. God loves every one of us exactly the same. Died for every single one of us. God says you're my kid. I want to bless you in the city and bless you in the field. Bless you coming, bless you going. My goodness sakes alive. God wants to go out, open doors that no man can open, close doors that no man can close. You got to be kidding me. And there are thought processes in our mind. We don't believe that about ourselves. And those are called strongholds. And he says, they put that back up there. I'll tell you when to put it down. Put it back. Come, put it back. Thank you. Casting down arguments. There's an argument going on in the inside of you. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. God's knowledge says you're blessed. God's knowledge, you're king's kid. God's knowledge is, hey, maybe you are illegal, but you ain't going back. You're here now. Guess what? And your kids are here now. Come on, somebody. Don't give me that. You don't even have to worry about that stuff. You know, everybody's picking on people coming across the border. But they ought to pick on us for not putting a wall up like every other country. Well, I'm not going there. I'm not going there. All I'm saying is thank God for our people that are Latinos in this country that make up a great American process. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus loves them. I'm telling you, someone said they're going to deport them. They're going to have a hard time deporting them. You all move into my house. Let them try to come and get you. Not getting out of this country at all. My goodness. Bring every thought into capacity to the obedience of Christ. Bring every thought, bring it down there. Get it, tie it up, hold it in place to the obedience of Christ. Every thought to what God says, that's what your thoughts are fixed on. Not how you feel, not how you think. Then he comes along. It makes this verse number 5, and he says this. I think that's all we have. But verse 6 is really, and then he says, punish those parts of your body that are disobedient. When it starts to think of something you shouldn't be thinking about, then don't let it go there and you stop yourself, because the war for your future is in your head. Let me tell you again, the war for your future is in your head. Second thing Debbie talked about, she talked about the church. Very important for us to see this, that the church itself is got authority. The church itself has the right way of doing things. And God says in this, in James, the 4th chapter, in verse number 6, pop it up on the overhead. James, 4th chapter, verse number 6, watch this. Now, watch this. But he gives more grace, therefore. And he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Now, the subject is about God giving grace, God's sovereign divine ability for you to get the job done when you can't do it. That's grace. So God gives you this grace, but he doesn't give it to the proud. He resists the proud. The proud says, I can do it myself. The grace goes to somebody that says, I need God. I need God. And this ability of God, this power of God that you need to get through the day, you need to pay your bills, you need to be a fabulous employee, you need to be a great employer, you need to run your own business, you need to make great decisions. May I say this to you? Listen closely. He says, but he gave more grace to those who say, so he says this in verse number 6, but he gives more grace. Therefore, go back to verse number 6, please. Therefore, see the word therefore? Because he wants to give grace to those that are humble. Humble is somebody who says, I need God. Watch this. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Now go to verse number 7. Right after he says that, he says, therefore, submit yourself to God. Can't submit yourself to God until you're humble. If you think you can do it yourself, it ain't going to work. If I'm going to win a battle, I got to go God's way to win the battle, not my way to win the battle. We've been trying to win battles of all these things that come at us all the time our own way. I know we'll get an education. I know we'll save our money. I know we'll borrow money. I know if someone just sent me a credit card, I'll run that up. That'll take care of it. And it's only momentary release When in fact, guess what he's talking about? If you'll be humble and depend on God, he'll give you the grace. That's his ability to get the job done when you can't do it. He says, resist the devil. What's the church's job to do? Resist. Resist the devil and he will do something. What's that word? Flee. Resist the devil and he will what? Flee. Resist the devil and he will what? Flee. Now, here's the crazy part about this. In your mind, you start resisting the devil, he doesn't flee. I remember when I was really sick with my back, doctor said the operation failed. I wasn't going to make it. It was just going to be this way for the rest of my life. I was so discouraged. I had it in my mind. I said, God, I'm not going to let this get to me. I'm not going to let this get to me. I kept saying. Every time I tried to do something, all of a sudden the attack would come in my mind. My back would hurt worse than ever before. I couldn't even make the effort to get out of it. It wasn't until I finally got to a place and said, I don't care what I feel like. I'm going to do what God wants me to do. And then I got healed. But eventually he realizes, because he's a proud spirit, isn't he? Remember, he was cast out of heaven because of pride. He's a proud spirit. Guess what? Eventually he realizes, I'm not giving up, and he's going to be shown up as a fool. He does what? Flees. Got to remember that, guys. I don't think there's ever a time that you ought to pray without doing the third one. By the way, if you remember, not only is it the church, but in the heavenlies. And I take you to Matthew, the 16th chapter. In verse number 18, 16th chapter of Matthew, verse 18 for the heavenlies, and it says this, and I also say unto you, Peter, on this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. So all of a sudden he says, I'm going to do something, Peter. On the revelation that you have, I'm going to build the church, and the gates of hell not prevail. And right after he says that, the very next thing he says, listen to this, is verse number 19, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Where did that come from? The gates of hell will not prevail, but I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. Did you know when you got born again, you got the keys to the kingdom? Sometimes you got a key, you don't know what lock it fits. Here's the lock. It fits in heaven and it fits on earth, and it's called the authority that's passed on from God to you. He says, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loosed on earth will be loosed in heaven. And a lot of times we don't understand that at all. We don't understand that principle. I think every time we ought to pray, we ought to make it very clear. Satan, I want you to know something. I bind you now in the name of Jesus from my family, from my business, from my finances, from my dreams, from my vision. I bind you now from attacking me in the area of my health. And I break your power right now by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I loose healing. I loose those finances. I loose, because the Bible says, whatever I bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever I loose on earth is loose. And I got to do the work. Someone can't do it for you. Follow me? So all of a sudden we forget this. So we come along, we be sweet little Christians. We come and clap our hands, sing our songs. You know, we listen to wonderful preaching. This church has the greatest preachers in the world. And we forget about binding the devil. And we forget about loosing the things that you need and been asking for. And we just conclude our prayers with, thank you, Jesus, amen. And all of a sudden, the devil now has a plan and he beats you from pillar to post. It doesn't come to pass. The war goes on inside of your brain. You never get any activity because you didn't take authority over who you ought to have taken authority over. The devil, who is a liar, thief, and a destroyer, wants to kill and destroy your whole family. And it's time for us as a church to realize we, every day of our life, are in a battle. And the only one that's going to hell is the devil, not us, and we're going to send him there. Are you listening? And it's just time for us, every time you pray this year, you need to take authority over every demonic activity, principality, and power that wants to get involved in your prayer, get involved in your mind, get involved in your church, and get involved in those prayers going to heaven. And you need to take authority over there and start beating the snot out of the devil before he beats the snot out of you. Come on, somebody. I'm finished and I quit. That's just the way it is. So from now on, when you pray, you take authority over the devil. He will rise up until he realizes you're serious. The attacks may even get worse. I'm warning you. But that doesn't mean you stop. That means you keep on going. He's played his card. And when he realizes you're not going to give up, the Bible says he will flee. Or in other words, he will give up. Come on, somebody. Come on, come on, come on. It's true. I take authority right now over this church in the name of Jesus. You foul thing, I break your power right now. You try to keep people from getting saved. You try to keep people from hearing the word. You try to keep people discouraged, frustrated. You try to keep people that are down and defeated. Well, in the name of Jesus, we take authority over you. You'll no longer hold these people back. We say it now and every day. Get your hands off of them. Get your hands off their heart. Get your hands off their mind. Get your hands off their wallet. Get your hands off their children. Get your hands off their family, get your hands off their future, get your hands off their vision, get your hands off their destiny, get your hands off their purpose, get your hands off this church. We bind you now in the name of Jesus. I don't know about you, but when I do that, I just feel better. You know it, and so do I. So why don't we do it all the time? We don't do it. We want to be nice little church-going people who don't want to fight. We just want things, and we got to fight. We're fighters. You're in the army of God. Amen?